President of the Technion, Professor Lavi, Modai family. There's a story about President Kennedy that was invited to visit the Alcatraz prison near, now it's closed, near San Francisco, and he had to address the inmates, and he didn't know how to open up his remarks, so he said, "I'm glad you are all here." So, this morning when I came here and I met Amos Chorev and then Gideon Frank and Yoram Alster, people whom I knew forever and worked with in former periods, reminded me of another story that I heard a few times from Joe Sisko, who was the Undersecretary of State in Washington under Kissinger, and he used to tell the story about this guy who was the only survivor of a flood in Johnstown, Pennsylvania back in 1889, and thereafter made his living on lecturing on how I survived the flood in Johnstown, Pennsylvania in 1889. Finally, when he got to the Almighty, which would happen to most of us, I assume, the angel in charge tells him, "Look, we have a club of the newcomers here. Why won't you introduce yourself?" He says, "Fine." He says, "What will be your topic?" He says, "I'll talk about how I survived the flood in Johnstown." So the angel says, "Look, it's such a narrow topic. Why won't you pick something more universal?" So the person says, "Well, that's all I know. I made my living on that." So the angel says, "Okay, if you want, go ahead, talk about that, but you should know that Noah is going to be in the audience." And some people here qualify for the Noah. As Ambassador Modai mentioned, I knew well Minister Modai of blessed memory in two incarnations. One, when he was Minister of Energy, when we negotiated peace with Egypt back in 1978, I'm a survivor of the Camp David talks of that period, and this was a success in a way, but then we had to go into details, and oil in Sinai was one of the items, and that was his field at the time. Later I became cabinet secretary under Prime Minister Shamir and Rabin. Minister Modai was Minister of Finance, very influential, as Ambassador Modai said, very outspoken, always spoke his mind. It wasn't always the appropriate thing politically. Maybe he paid the price for that. But he was a smart man, a good-hearted man, a partner in rescuing Israel's economy in the mid-80s after the mega inflation that prevailed at the time. And he also was a complex person, no question. And it was always interesting, challenging, and you know that whatever he was working on was for the country, for the well-being of Israel. I also knew Mrs. Modai of blessed memory, which was, besides being a beautiful lady, that is something you can say because she was a queen beauty at the early years of the state. She was a leader of WITSO, and this event brings memories from those days. To be frank, I'm not, Professor Golani mentioned, I have no technological background or anything even close to that, and my only connection to the Technion, besides many friends, is that I have a nephew who studies medicine here now. But this important institution is a pillar of Israeli academic life. In fact, it was the first, as far as I know, institution of higher education in this country. and established during the Ottoman period, who would believe that? I mean, so it's also something to mark. I'm very proud of having served the state of Israel. If you include the army years, it's about 50 years. It sounds like a dinosaur, but it was a very rewarding journey. Today is my 71st birthday. I forgot about it, but there are ages that you don't want to be, but it's why do I mention that? Because I saw June 13th on the that was a year ago today that I retired from the court, a major part of my work was really, Professor Golani mentioned it, taking part in the peace negotiations of Israel with its neighbors, which some of them bore fruit. Egypt, Jordan, thank God, the Egyptian Camp David is 40 years now, Jordan will be 25 years next year. Some others were not too successful, but as we have here people from abroad who are benefactors and members of the Technion family, I'd like to underline the importance of the relationship between Israel and world Jewry, American Jewry from other places. I know there are strains, some of them shouldn't have happened. We can talk about it, but that's not our topic. But the bond, the relationship, the fraternity between Israel and world Jewry is not only a pillar of our existence, but also a critical part of the of Jewish history and the values on which we all grew up. And we, of course, the best thing from our point of view would be that whoever can come would make Aliyah, would join us in building the country. But support from abroad is also important. And I really am happy that the continued support of Jews from abroad to this institution is expressing itself today. I was involved personally in creating or in forging the strategic cooperation between the United States and Israel in the 1980s and throughout the next decade or so, including the first public memorandum of agreement between Israel and the United States, which was signed by President Reagan and Prime Minister Shamir on our 40th Day of Independence in 1988. And the strategic relations continued regardless of which administration was in power or on the helm in the United States, in the helm. And this year is a remarkable year because the American embassy was moved to Jerusalem, something which we were hoping for many years. Back in 88, I chaired the committee that allocated the plot, the piece of land to the American government in Jerusalem to establish the embassy. It took 30 years before this is starting, but I hope it will be done as soon as possible. Let me go to our subject. And Israel is a Jewish and democratic state. What's a democratic state? Everybody knows there are models all over the world, not too many, not as much as we would like to see, but democracy, free elections, freedom of speech, freedom of press and media, etc. These are the elements which make a democracy function, and there's no question that Israel is a democracy, and I think a unique democracy, inter alia, because it is the only democracy that fulfills the tenets of democracy while being under threats, security threats, even existential threats throughout its existence. In fact, not known to many people, people don't think about it, but Israel was a democracy not only from its beginning in 48, but also in the pre-state period, because the Zionist movement, as well as the what's known as the Yishuv, or the Jewish community throughout the mandatory period, were based on elections, not full-fledged in the sense that we talk about usually, but on elections, on elected institutions. This is something which is unusual for entities which were under colonial rule, as we were under the British, and definitely before that under the Ottomans. But Israel is a Jewish and democratic state. This is expressed in the two basic laws. You know, as well as I keep a Mishnah here from the Jewish law, I am also keeping in my, I took out my wallet not to get a tip from you, but I keep in my wallet the Declaration of Independence and the two basic laws of human rights in civil rights of Israel, which are the constitutional altogether. These three documents are a basic elements, basic components of our constitutional fabric. Israel is not only a democratic state, it's a Jewish democratic state. What does Jewish mean? That's a good question, because it has never been fully described, fully defined, but it is the nation state of the Jewish people. The most significant expression of that is what's known as the law of return, Chok HaShvut, which is the law that was promulgated in the early years of the state and says every Jew has the right to come to Israel, which means a Jew comes here, automatically gets citizenship, which is very unusual, but that's the answer to the thousands of years of persecution, the thousands of years of exile, and of course in particular the terrible period of the Holocaust, of the Shoah, which Jews were roaming from one port to the other, like the St. Louis ship or other examples, trying to get refuge and couldn't get refuge and were later exterminated. And the law of return is an answer to that. But there are other components of Judaism, the Sabbath being the day of rest, of course. There are many questions about the character of the Shabbat. How should it look? For religious people, it's one thing. For secular people, it's another thing. For traditional people, it's a third thing. What do you do? These are challenges which come to the court. I will talk about the court in a minute. The question of like conversion. Who is a Jew? A Jew is defined in our law as somebody who was born to a Jewish mother or converted and is not a member of another religion. But what does conversion mean? Another question. The whole relations between the Israeli government, the Israeli people, and the diaspora Jews, including the question of the place under the sun, which should be and has to be for non-Orthodox people, conservative people, reformed people, and so on and so forth. So all these questions are around. But the bottom line is that it is a Jewish state. The miracle of the ingathering of the exiles. If you take my own family, you have we come from Russia, my parents, but my wife's family comes from Poland. And then when you go to sisters, brothers, brothers-in-law, sons-in-law, and so on, you have Morocco, you have Iraq, you have Kurdistan, you have Turkey, you have, and of course, the ingathering and melting pot has been very, very impressive here. Also, the Hebrew language. There was this well-known writer here, Kishon, who used to say that it's the only country where the mothers learn the mother tongue from the children. And when I was growing up, which was in the 50s, I vividly remember my friends who... My parents spoke Hebrew at home, but my friends, many of them, I remember a kid who later became an important scientist who was from Hungarian extraction. And when his mother would call him in Hungarian to come back home when we were playing soccer, well, I was the great player, to be frank. But he used to yell to her that if she ever again speaks, he was ashamed she speaks Hungarian to him, he'll never come back home. Well, I assume he did come home, but the idea of multitude of languages, Arabic, Polish, Hungarian, just name it, around when I was growing up. So it's a big challenge to live and define and work in this Jewish state, which also has a minority of 20% of Arabs, could be Christians, could be Muslims, could be Druze. Here in Haifa is a mixed city. The challenge is how, and that's the must, and that's the order, how to, on one hand side, have Israel as the Jewish state, the Jewish and democratic state, as a national state of the Jewish people, but on the other hand, and in the same way and without hesitation, work for equality of rights to an Arab citizen, so that an Arab kid, like a Jewish kid, when they would have the same chances when they are growing up, and the rights of equality would be maintained. So, and now I'm here in Haifa lives my good friend and colleague who retired together with me last year, Justice Jubran. Today, he's an Arab Christian. Today, he's becoming an honorary citizen of Haifa this afternoon. And yesterday. Well, I always miss a day somehow. Okay. So he he's already an honorary citizen of Haifa, and a proud Arab, a proud Christian, a proud Israeli, proud justice when he was on the bench. So this kind of status for an Israeli Arab, he was the first Arab in a full-fledged appointment to the court, is very heartwarming. The Supreme Court of Israel is different from the from parallel institutions elsewhere. If you take the, let me give you just a numerical example. If you take the U.S., Canada, Britain, each of these has, of course, a Supreme Court, and they have, each of them has like 70, 80 cases a year, 70 to 80 cases a year. How many cases does Israeli Supreme Court have? How many?
Same number, but a day.
Well, it's not far from the truth. Last year, I think we had about a little bit more than 10,000 cases. And when I came on the court back in 2004, it was 12,000 cases. But then there was some minor legislative changes that enabled us to bring a little bit. So an Israeli Supreme Court justice is a slave. And when I said goodbye last year, it was like coming out of slavery, starting breathing, taking the chain, breaking the chain, and so on. So that's a numerical matter. But there's another point of interest, and maybe of greater interest. Our court deals, of course, with criminal cases, with civil cases, with administrative cases, like any other Supreme Court. But there's one thing which distinguishes our court, and which is hardly in existence anywhere, which is known as the High Court of Justice, power, or what's known in Hebrew as Bagatz, Bet Mishpat Gavua LeTzedek, High Court of Justice. And this is the court sitting as a court of original jurisdiction, that is the first instance on matters related to government decisions and to decisions of government agencies. That means that you can petition against the government or its agencies right to the Supreme Court. You don't have to go through the echelon of courts like elsewhere. And this is this means that many, many subjects which are on the national agenda constantly would come to the court as a way to challenge the government decisions. Now, this started with a very modest British mandatory power of the British mandatory court, but has been developed by the Israeli Supreme Court. Some people keep criticizing it throughout the years. And in fact, in the early 80s, around 1980, the court also did away with the need to show standing. Because when I was in law school in the second half of the 60s, they taught us that in order to go to the High Court of Justice, you have to show your relations to the case. Why are you petitioning? Because you personally were affected negatively by a government decision or something of the kind. From the around 1980, you don't have to show this, and so many voluntary associations, and of course, people from the public, Knesset members, in a way like, if you want, like the marketplace in Athens or like the biblical gate of the city, you can come to the court. And of course, this makes the court, in a way, a player in the national arena. And that also brings criticism, because for quite a number of circles, more conservative, more religious in Israel, the court is perceived as too secular, too liberal, too left-wing, maybe. There's a lot of exaggeration in these criticisms, and many of them are based on a false understanding of the facts. But that's part of our general discourse in the public, and we live with it. The court lives with it. And from about part of the criticism, I can tell you, being a veteran civil servant, for many years, many, many years before I came on the court, I used to say and write that if you put on a scale, on one side, the good news about the court, the benefits that it brought to the country and to the people, and on the other hand, those points of criticism, which is legitimate. It's a part of the freedom of expression. There's no question you can criticize. If you put the two, there's no question in my mind, and I say it not only now, I'm not fully objective, I was for many years on the court, but many years earlier, I was convinced that the benefits are by much more significant than the other side. By the way, in appointing people to the court, which is not always a fight, in particular recently, I was for a few years on the selection committee. I should mention that we have a unique system of selecting judges throughout the echelon, from the traffic court all the way to the Supreme Court. It was a system that was introduced in 1953. I wrote the first book on it many, many years ago. It's a mix of political personalities and non-politicals. It's a nine-person committee. The chair is a minister, which is a political person. And there's another minister, chair and minister of justice, another minister too. And then two Knesset members, traditionally one coalition, one opposition. It's not exactly this fact now. And five non-politicals, which are the three justices of the Supreme Court, the president and two others that rotate, and two members or representatives of the Bar Association. So you have nine people. And in my view, and again, I'm not fully objective, but I think it's well known abroad and in Israel, but you know, sometimes we have a saying in our tradition, there's no prophet in its own city. In Israel, the discourse, the debate is sometimes very sharp, but abroad, and I visited many parallel courts abroad, and we have exchanges with the Canadians and with the British and with the French and with even the Russians and with the and many other countries and Germans. There's great respect to the court because it has won throughout the years its name of independence of the political system, and I think that this is an asset, I would say a strategic asset for the state of Israel, that there's an independent judiciary that functions based on the law, based on the constitutional values of the country. I'll come in a minute to the constitutional question. The court now consists of 15 justices. There are four women, not enough, but four women. We already had five. There's one Arab, maybe not enough. Should be at least two, but that's the current picture. And and there are four of the, I would say, religious Zionist circles, like myself. If you take the Yarmulke, the kippah, is a sign. One of them is a woman, and she covers her head, so it's not exactly the same kippah. But and she is from Haifa, by the way. We now have, I think, how many? At least two justices from Haifa. Two, I'm sure, but maybe more. Anyhow, Israel doesn't have a full-fledged constitution. You can't go into a bookstore and buy the Israeli constitution the way you can buy the American constitution and its amendments as a matter of routine. We have, though, 12 basic laws. Ben-Gurion, the founding father, back in the early years of the state, understood that despite the commitment to the UN in 47 and 48 to establish a constitution, both the fact that there was only a minority of the Jewish people world Jewry in Israel, and the fact that the Israeli-Arab conflict was raging, that we shouldn't go into a full-fledged constitution. And on June 13, today, 1950, a Knesset this resolution was passed to go into the path of basic laws. That is to promulgate basic laws, which would at the end be incorporated and packaged into a full-fledged constitution. So we have 12 basic laws. In my personal view, it's already long due to finalize the constitutional enterprise. The fact that it doesn't happen is, although it's not difficult in terms of what we already have in terms of basic laws to do it, is the one of the main reasons is that religious parties, or at least the ultra-religious parties, don't want the court to be the interpreter, and they have a problem with the judiciary. And this is something which is already history, because since 1995, or how shall I put it, in 1992, the two last basic laws were promulgated. One, those that I have here, one is human freedom and dignity, and the other is the freedom of employment. Those two, when you read them simply, you don't need big resolutions or court decisions of 300 pages, which happened. When you read them simply as a first-year law student, you can see that they gave the court the power to interpret laws versus the basic laws, what's known in the U.S. as judicial review, or that those Euro-Americans all know the Marbury and Madison case back in 1803, because even the U.S. Constitution doesn't include an explicit saying that the court can perform judicial review, but the court interpreted back in the early 19th century, Chief Justice Marshall, into a judicial review system. The same here back in 95 in a case called Bank HaMizrahi versus Migdal, the court interpreted in a very long decision. In my view, it's very nice to have long decisions with dignity and so on, but you can, in 10 pages, you could summarize the idea that the court has the power of judicial review, and the court does it in a measured way. We understand, the court understands that this is, we speak about not government decisions here, but on Knesset laws, which is the expression of the will of the people, so you're very cautious, but it's being done. And that's part of the fight that's going on now, which I'll mention. Let me just give you a few examples of the non-constitutional issues, but the public law issues, which the court has been involved over the years, to show the gamut, or the spectrum of the judicial work in terms of the High Court of Justice. Gender, rights of women. The court has been very instrumental in promoting rights of women. In my lifetime, I saw the almost a revolution in that. It's not finalized. It's never finalized. They speak always of the glass ceiling or whatever, which is true that it's but we are all the time making progress, and the court made a major contribution to that. Famous case, which I'll mention, was back in the early 90s, a lady by the name of Alice Miller wanted to become an Air Force pilot. The Air Force wouldn't accept women as pilots at the time, and despite the fact that, by the way, that early in the years of the state, there were women pilots. In fact, there was a professor here in the Technion, his wife, Yossi Rom, his wife, Yael Rom, was a, I knew her well, she was a pilot in the early, but later on it somehow faded away, and the Ms. Miller wanted to become a pilot. And the Air Force said no. I was at the time, this is early 90s, the General Counsel of the Ministry of Defense. And I tried to convince in a memo, late Prime Minister and Defense Minister Rabin, of blessed memory, still can't live with the fact that, this wicked person killed him some years later. Amos Chochev was his friend and his pal in the Palmach and in the 1948 Independence War. I tried to convince him to, I said, it's the spirit of the era. If it doesn't happen today, it will happen in a year or two or three. Why not say yes? But the Air Force was vehement, and they had some reasons, some logistic, which is less important, but one of the reasons they gave was not, I mean, it has some meaning, but I thought it was, it couldn't be the decisive factor, that if, God forbid, a woman who's a pilot falls as a prisoner of war in our neighborhood with our neighbors, doesn't bode good for her. That was the main reasoning. And Rubin was a general himself, accepted, and that was the position the government came with to the court, and the court decided against the government, and the rest of history. Ms. Miller herself did not make it. I mean, she could not, she did not finish the course, but there are now quite a number, multitudes, but quite a number of women who are Air Force pilots, navigators, and also naval combat officers and other. So this is something which just an example. And recently, in my last year on the court, I wrote the decision that again, it hasn't yet been materialized, but the principle that a woman can be the director of the rabbinical courts, because in Israel, you know, the marriage and divorce are under the various religious denominations. Jews, Muslims, Druze, Christians, all of them. By the way, there's already an Arab woman who is a Muslim judge, religious judge, but not a Jewish religious judge, but the petition was on the director of religious courts, and we decided in favor of the women's rights on that. Questions of minorities, equality of minorities, questions of Palestinians, settlements, a lot of questions like that. And the court, by the way, I mentioned, it's a strategic asset to the state. When the what's known as the Second Intifada broke in 2000, it took a couple of years of terrible massacres in coffee shops, in buses, in bus stations, what have you, in wedding halls. And the government decided on the security fence. I was still the Attorney General. I used to call the Minister of Defense at the time Minister of the Fence, because that's all we were talking about. And then people from the Palestinian organization, so on, and the court, I should have mentioned, opened its gates to Palestinians, to petition Palestinians on their behalf, despite the fact that international law does not necessitate that. Chief Justice Shamgar, then the Attorney General, 68, probably understood that it's not going to be a short journey, so he basically opened the gates for Palestinians to petition. And there were petitions on the validity of the fence legally, and the international law, and so on. And there was a Hague court resolution, very shallow. I shouldn't go into that, but nothing to write home about. But there were petitions in our court. And the court, under President Barak, wrote a decision which said the fence is legal because The government has a commitment and obligation to defend its citizens and whoever lives here. So if that's something that would save life, defend people, that's fine. But since Palestinians in the villages around the fence had difficulties now with the fence of access to the fields, took more time, say 40 minutes except for 10 minutes or whatever, the court went, and I, in later years, I was already on the court and I was set on some of these petitions, went sector by sector of the fence to check the problems and rerouted the fence so as to ease the conditions for the Palestinians. Ever since, it has gone off the international agenda because the court had established on one side the principle of the defense of the nation and of people, of course, and the other is the human rights side or the civil rights of those Palestinians who were affected by the erection of the court. So state and religion issues are very much on the agenda of the court, and of course these are maybe in a way the most sensitive because within Israel there's no consensus on everything in this. I mentioned Shabbat, I mentioned conversion. This is an audience which may have most of the people here one world view on these things, and the other audiences another world view. I remember I gave a lecture some years ago in Tel Aviv University, and I spoke about the Chafetz Chaim. Chafetz Chaim is a well-known rabbi of the 19th century, died before the Holocaust, who a big halachic authority. And I asked about 400 people in the university in the hall, and I said, how many know about the Chafetz Chaim? And maybe 20, 30 people, there are streets named Chafetz Chaim, but I speak of the person, 20. And I said, look, here's the diversity of Israel as a complex society. If we drive from here 20 minutes to Bnei Brak, which is an ultra-religious town near Tel Aviv, if we drive 20 minutes from the university to Bnei Brak, every child who is 7 and up knows who is the Chafetz Chaim and what he wrote. So, and the court has to cope in its work with the question, the fact that the country is complex and has Jews, religious Jews, secular Jews, ultra-religious Jews, traditional Jews, Arabs of all kinds. The Arabs also, not only the, there are also intra-Arab problems or cases connected with religious codes of the Arabs. We don't have the time to go into that. Let me say just three short remarks. One is the constitutional matter has been now on the public agenda. Because it, by the way, by accident, and I'm in a way responsible. I retired a year ago, and the two other justices retired in 2-3 months or 4 months after my retirement. So there was and we babysit cases. I don't know how many of you would know about that, but in the U.S. or in England or wherever, when they have a case in the court, they take a case, they pick the cases. They argue, the lawyers argue, half an hour here, go home. In 2-3 months, you'll have a decision, goodbye. In Israel, we have also babysitting, which means we sometimes try to convince the government or the Knesset to do whatever is needed, and without a big decision and without a kind of black and white decision. But and so it takes time, sometimes years, sometimes we have 4-5 sittings on the same case to sessions of the court to convince the government. If we don't succeed, we have to decide. And the retirement of three justices was necessitated finalizing cases in which we were involved. So suddenly it became kind of an image as if the court has kind of attacked the Knesset. There's a what would be known in Arabic as alehum, which means a kind of a vehement attack on the Knesset. Nothing of that kind. It was just a mere incident. But so there's now an attempt to curb the court I don't want to go into the details, but something which doesn't exist anywhere except for Canada, and even in Canada it was never used by the federal court, how to overcome, override cases which were decided by the court. In my personal view, I don't think that this is necessary, that it's not needed. The court is cautious, it's professional, it explains every decision so you can read why the decision was taken. It is, and it, as I said, it's an asset in terms of Israel's image in the world, and it's a protector of minorities, of weakened populations in Israel. So the there's really, if I, and I think on that I speak rather objectively, there's no need for that. I think that all these efforts, I'd like them to be aborted, and I think that the court is listening. We are not, as Justice Barak used to say, we're not on the Olympics. We are in the Jerusalem mountains. We live within the people. So I don't think there's a need to change or to curb the powers of the court. I wanted to speak a little bit about Jewish law and its part in our ethos. You know, we have a very rich tradition of law in the, which is not the law of the country, but is one of the sources of the law of the country. You have the Bible, you have the Mishnah, you have the two Talmud books, you have the all the responsa, you have the Maimonides, you have the codifications. This is now part of the inspiration and the sources of the law of Israel. And I think I'm mentioning that because sometimes people think of Jewish law as being a business for the religious people. It's not. It's a national treasure. So thank you very much. And I hope that this short talk, I could just give the basics of the court's work. And I think it should be continued. Thank you very much.